very warm welcome to each and every one of you to worship this morning. This week we pick up a two-week sort of series on stewardship. We'll talk a bit more about that in a few moments. But let's come before God now with our prayer of praise and confession. Let's pray. Blessed are you, Lord our God. Glorious is your name in all the earth. We celebrate who you are and all that you have done for us. You hold our lives in your hands and catch us when we stumble. And we come together today, led by your Holy Spirit, to worship you, to sing your praise, to confess our mistakes, and to receive your love and mercy made possible through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. Be present among us as we worship you and as we open ourselves to your word. God, your way is one of giving. You love this world so much that you sent your own Son, Jesus Christ, who lived our life, died our death, and rose again, in order that we might have life. Forgive us when we struggle to share that abundant life with others. Forgive us when we fall for the lie that life is all about acquiring things. Forgive us if we live as though we were at the center of things. Help us again and again to choose love, compassion, kindness, and justice over self-interest. Teach us again and again what it means to live as children of the light, to live generously, sharing our abundance with our brothers and sisters in need. In the name of Christ, Amen. In Christ, there is life. With Christ, there is freedom. Because of Christ, there is hope. Hear then the words of Christ to us. Your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And continuing our theme of giving thanks for the good things that God blesses us with and that we are stewards of, let's sing, give thanks.
Yeah.
The kind of theme that I want to pick up today is about letting go, letting go. And when I was at university the first time, many, many, many moons ago, I did one unit of psychology. Actually, it was it's quite interesting because the guy who clearly it was for the sort of like science students who had to do something else other than science. So the lecturer was not, I don't think, the top grade psychology lecturer. He spent most of his time smoking French cigars or cigarettes. It was quite strange. Anyway, I got a good mark for it, so there was something for it. Anyway, he said to us on one occasion, and you don't have to do this, by the way, this is the SBS warning at the beginning. He said, I've got a way of suggesting, and Isabel, you can correct me afterwards if I've got this completely wrong, but this is what he told us. This is what he told us. He said, if I've got a way of telling whether you can be hypnotized or not. So we looked at him and thought, Now, you don't have to do this, all right? What he said was to put your hands together like that. You can do it if you want. And you can't pull them apart, can you? You just can't pull them apart, can you? Well, now, the trick is, of course, that of course you can. But if you just keep there and listen to what I'm saying, you can't pull them apart, can you? You're more likely to be open to suggestion. That's what he said. Whether there's any basis for that whatsoever, I don't know, but that's what he told me. But I was thinking about this and thinking about stuff and letting go of stuff. And sometimes we sort of get a bit like that, don't we, with stuff. We can't let go of it. We can't let go of it. So think about that, eh? Think about that. Actually, I'm wondering whether I've hypnotized myself here. What was that, Jenny? You know what's in my garage. I try to get rid of some of it. So there we have someone who's very happy to let go. To let go. Let's listen to our passage of scripture in which Jesus had some pretty challenging things to say to us about travelling and the stuff we carry with us in life. Thanks, Joy.
The gospel reading is from Luke 10, 1 to 11. After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace to this house.' And if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the labourer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town, and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near.' Your word, O Lord, is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path."
Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This is a fascinating passage. It's a great one for a Bible study because when you stop and think about it, there's so much in these few verses to grapple with. First of all, that Jesus sends out 70 others, not just the 12. I wonder who those 70 people were. Did the 70 include Mary Magdalene and the other Mary? And then there's this great lengthy briefing that Jesus gives to his disciples about the ministry that they're going on. They're to go in pairs. They're to go in pairs. Is that for safety? Or is it, perhaps it is, but is it also to indicate that this isn't about individuals doing their own thing? It's about a community engaged in ministry. And then they're told that they're not going to find it easy. They'll be like lambs in the midst of wolves. Surely there was someone at the back of the group who put their hand up and said, "Is this really a good idea, Lord?" And they're to bless the houses that they are to arrive in and bless the people in those houses with the peace of God, the shalom of God, whether the peace is received or whether it isn't. That's worth thinking about. They're to be open to what the locals provide for them, prepared to accept whatever accommodation is offered, even if it isn't the presidential suite. They're to be prepared to eat whatever meals are put in front of them. And as a minister who has had lots of morning teas, this is practical advice, brothers and sisters. And the message that they're to offer is the same message that Jesus offered. And this is to whether people accept it or not, that the kingdom of God is near. And then there's that business about dusting off their feet when they're rejected and moving on. Now, there's a lot there we could struggle with and think about. But my focus this morning, because we're reflecting on the theme related, a theme related to stewardship, is that they are not to overpack. Not to overpack. We could have a conversation now about what you take with you when you go on a trip. Who has the biggest bag? You know, they ask Jesus, "How many suitcases?" Actually, he says, "You don't need any. You're to travel light." But I couldn't possibly survive without my name thing that you couldn't possibly survive without. Phone, I don't know, anorak, whatever. No, Jesus says, you're to travel light. And of course, Jesus actually says, if you listen to it in the text, carry no purse, no bag, no sandals. Now that's a bit rich, isn't it? Like, it's not an easy message to digest. But as we've started to think about through their a little exercise earlier, recognising that there are lots of things we don't need is actually a freeing thing. These words of Jesus are a word of grace to us. Letting go our attachment to stuff is a freeing thing. Isn't it? Yeah, it is. Have you heard of Maslow's hierarchy of needs? You know what the bottom one is? It's about the... Do you say no? Well, it doesn't matter. I won't go through all of it because when I started to look at the whole pyramid, it's very complicated. But Maslow has this pyramid of needs. But the bottom one is basic physiological needs. Things that we all need, like water, like air, like food, like basic shelter. Things that unfortunately there are too many people on this planet that don't have enough of. And why is that so? We cannot live without such things. But what Jesus, of course, is talking about is our relationship with stuff in general. How do we think about the things we have? How do we relate to them? The process of downsizing, which some of you have been through, or just clearing out a family house, which I've been through, does make you think a bit. Yes, Jenny, yes, there's still some of it in the garage, I know. But it's healthy to remember as the source of all these things. Psalm 24, verse 1, "The earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it." Remembering that the material things of this world are of God. We're not the owners, we're stewards. We're stewards even of our own lives. Nothing is ours, it's God's. You know the old joke, don't you? And I've already shared this with Bob this morning, and he knew it. There's this chap, they're having a discussion about stewardship. And so this chap draws a circle on the ground, and he has a pocket full of money. And he says, "Now, watch, I'm going to throw this up into the air. And what God keeps is his, and what falls to the ground's mine." Now, there is so much wrong with that. It does bring a laugh, though, doesn't it? There is so much wrong with that. There is so much wrong with that. For a start, it assumes that somehow God is up there somewhere. We do that. We naturally point to God being up there, but that's an assumption that's where God is. When in fact, the whole story of Jesus, in fact, the whole biblical story is about a God who journeys with us, who is close. It also assumes that somehow God's up in heaven and collects things that are material. The material world's nothing to do with God. It's everything to do with God. It's everything to do with God. The practical things of life are blessings from God. The issue is, how do we relate to them? What do they mean for us? Do we see ourselves as stewards? They're the core questions. The fact that the church, I often say that the two things that the Uniting Church has struggled with over the last 40 years are sexuality and property. Because how we relate to material things as a church is about being good stewards, and it's not easy. But Jesus' gracious words to us are that we are to travel light. That we need to recognize that, in a sense, everything we have is a gift from God. Everything. All the money on the floor is God's, not just the stuff that stayed up in space. And so life is about traveling light with these things, not holding on, but traveling light, and recognizing that as good stewards, if we do that, we have the space to genuinely invest in the things that count. Rich relationships, love of neighbor, love of God, love of self. If we're good stewards of the material things, then we can invest in the things that offer abundant life to others. Amen. I'm going to suggest that we use another affirmation from Bruce Prewer. Now, I will theologically correct Bruce at one point before we start, because I really like this affirmation of Bruce's, but he doesn't mention the Spirit of God at any point in it. But just assume that this is all led by the Spirit. But I think it's a really wonderful affirmation of the goodness of God to us. So I invite you to share with me in it. "We believe in the debonair God who clothes the wild flowers, dressing them so superbly that they outdo Solomon in all his glory, who is the true friend of creatures great and small, who feeds magpies and laughing kookaburras, and even doleful ravens and drongos. We believe in the extravagant God who turns the other cheek, who goes the second mile, turns water into the best wine, brings healing with his every touch, and who welcomes a woman's love as she fills the house with unforgettable fragrance. We believe in the redeeming God, who spared no cost, forgave even his brutal crucifiers, had time for a dying thief at his side, and who on the third day did a thing so prodigious that even his friends were dismayed with joy. Amen. Amen. Drongo, by the way, is a bird, in case you didn't know. The debonair god, yeah. Debonair is sort of like free, full of life. Yeah, Bruce loves his words. Let's sing about this debonair God who blesses us in so many ways, and which we are called to be stewards of his love and care, the God who in Jesus kneels at the feet of his friend. Please be seated. Let's take the opportunity to offer our gifts to God, and we'll actually send the plates around if you haven't had the opportunity to make an offering. We'll just give you that opportunity if there's anyone who needs to pop it in and hasn't had that chance. We're just returning to normal slowly on our offering. Okie doke. So if you just walk around. Please stand. O Lord, giver of life and source of our freedom, we are reminded that yours is the earth in all its fullness, and the world and those who dwell in it. We know that it is from your hand that we have received all that we have and are and will be. Gracious and loving God, we understand you call us to be the stewards of your abundance, the caretakers of all that you have entrusted to us. Help us always to use your gifts wisely and teach us to share them generously. May our faithful stewardship bear witness to the love of Christ in our lives. We pray this with grateful hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Thank you. So, Sue, have you got something to share? Yes, all right. Well, I'll say a few things and I'll hand to you. First of all, just to be aware that next week, through various means, you'll be given an opportunity to reflect on your own stewardship and giving to the life and ministry of this church. So there'll be material coming up out in the monthly magazine. There'll be a special supplement on stewardship. So we'll be following that up again next week and you'll have an opportunity. Secondly, the Synod of the Uniting Church, it sort of did some of it on Zoom and it's continued in person, I think in Box Hill Town Hall, over the last few days. And David Fotheringham, who is the chap on the left, is the new moderator. He was installed, apparently you install moderators. It always makes me think of about changing light bulb. But anyway, installing David happened on Thursday evening, and Denise Leish on the right, who has been the current moderator during this difficult time of COVID, relinquished her responsibility at that time. So they've been meeting in Box Hill Town Hall with the wonderful theme, Arise, Come With Me. And apparently, if you're interested, there's stuff on the webpage, you can even see some of it online. So if that's an interest to you, that's been happening, concludes today. And Robin Hodge has been attending, so Robin's been present. The other thing I wanted to say was that yesterday we had a wonderful wedding at Ormond College for Bron and Darcy. So it went really well, and the heaters were working, so we didn't shiver too much. And these wonderful flowers came from the wedding. So we're kind of connected to the wedding through the flowers.
Can you let us know whether Darcy arrived after Bron?
No, Darcy was there before I was, and I was there 50 minutes beforehand, so... He was there with plenty of time. No, it was a really, really lovely time. And Jenny Grover sang beautifully. And my Jenny has it videoed on her phone, but you can't all look at that. You can all to see the beautiful singing of the prayer in English by Jenny. Sue. And we'll go through the rest of the slides, Jean, after Sue's done her thing.
Good morning, everybody. It's not very exciting. All I want to do is remind the Mission Outreach people that we have a meeting on Thursday afternoon at 1:30, possibly here or there, depending on the availability. Thank you.
So if we just flick through the slides, Jean, thanks. Yep. Yes, we're having Christmas in July for the collectibles. The Robin's on a bit of leave, so yes, we will be trying to staff the office, but there might be times when there's not someone there. So Will's running his prayers by the river again. Hope he's got his winter woolies on Tuesday. Our normal prayer gathering on Zoom is on, and you can contact me or go to the webpage if you want to find how to get onto that. And the Repair Cafe is coming up. And midweek worship the following week. Yeah. I think that's all there. Ian, sorry.
Sorry, my understanding is there is no Repair Cafe because of school holidays on the 9th of July. I believe that's incorrect.
All right, so that could be wrong. All right, fair enough. Yes, Linda. All right. So there's more rhubarb this week. So, but you've got to get in early because it didn't survive long last week. Thanks. Yeah, so no repair cafe, but that's probably listed in the system. That's why Mike's put it up correctly, because he's followed what it says. Let's share in our prayers of intercession. Just conscious. I thought we might focus on the broader world today a little. Let's pray. There's a response, by the way, after Lord in your mercy, please share in the words, hear our prayer. Compassionate God, in whose love we live and move and have our being, you sent your Son to the world out of love for the world. And we pray for our world in which so many cry out to feel loved, wanted, cherished, and valued. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world in which too many places are torn apart by conflict and war. We pray for all those who live uneasily in a climate of fear, waking each day with no sense that the new day will be any better than the previous one. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world where too often the focus is on self and not on the needs of others. We pray that your path of reconciliation and healing might hold sway in these days, when we see much in the way of division and distrust in the world around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those caught up in the frenetic pace of things and life, so busy that they find it hard to find time to enjoy this world you have created, so preoccupied with living that they are unable or find it hard to appreciate life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the church, especially the church in Australia. Enable us as followers of Christ in this land to hold fast to Jesus' way. And may we be open to find ways to share faith in this increasingly secularized country. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray a word of thanks, O Lord, for the beauty and wonder of your creation. May we human beings recognize we are stewards of it and called to be good stewards of it. May we care for all that you've given us and not pollute this world as we have in so many ways in past days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we hold before you those known to us, whose names and faces are particularly in our minds at this time, because they're either celebrating special joys in their lives or they're going through times of need and hardship. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring these and all our prayers to you in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray together and to say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our final hymn this morning picks up part of the theme of our gospel lesson, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
Thank you.
sisters and brothers go from this place in the power of the Holy Spirit to fulfill your high calling as servants of Christ. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and remain with you all, both now and always. Amen. Amen. Amen.